गुड मॉर्निंग ऑल, एम आई ऑडिबल टू एवरीवन? गुड मॉर्निंग. सो टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट आवर सेशन. इन दिस सेशन आई विल बी टॉकिंग अबाउट ऑल द प्रोग्राम्स. सो वी हैव कंप्लीटेड आवर सीएनएन लेक्चर यस्टरडे एंड आई वाज सपोज्ड टू डू दिस सेशन ऑन लैब. Yesterday, the third session was supposed to be a lab session. However, I prefer to continue with the CNN theory instead of stopping it, restarting with the session today morning, because I feel when I start CNN, it is in a continuation and I should complete that in one go. So I did that. I completed the concepts related to convolutional neural network. Somebody is asking, please share deep learning content. What content you want? Okay, so everything is shared on the Google Drive. Please access the Google Drive. Okay. So today we will be dealing with the leftover programs, which was supposed to be done yesterday in the third session, and then I'll start with the CNN. So let's begin. Right, this program should be with you. I have shared all the programs. Okay, I have shared all the programs which were supposed to be with you, and you should see them in your folder. In this folder, the FDP on deep learning by IIIT NR, the folder, Google Drive folder that I have shared with you, there are four folders which contains cats and dogs, a small data set, then collab codes, slides, video recordings. Okay, video recordings have been obtained till day three video recordings are still downloading, so I will share them again by end of day. And the collab codes that I have shared with you include the four classes that I have shared last time, all as well as a new folder containing three programs, DL4, DL4A, and DL Visual ConNets, right? And the video recordings are there. As you can see, there are six sessions for two days. I have already shared them. So you should be able to see and access everything that we are supposed to do today. Right. So let us open the program, DL Class 2. DL Class 2, I had briefly discussed that day, and I'll just rush through this program. If you face any problem, just unmute yourself and speak, okay? Because sometimes I miss some of the messages. So anyhow, I'm trying to manage, but please, if you want to say something, unmute yourself and say it. Is my screen not visible?
मुनिंद्र सर, दिस इज अ रिक्वेस्ट के अगर एक बार आप शुरू से इस चीज को टेक केयर कर देंगे, हाउ टू मैप दिस पर्टिकुलर पाथ वंस अगेन, बिकॉज़ आई मिस्ड इट लास्ट टाइम.
यस सर, डेफिनेटली मैप द पाथ. ओके सो व्हाट आई विल डू, आई विल ओपन अ न्यू टैब, एंड ऑन दिस न्यू टैब वी द गूगल कोलैब. सो द यूआरएल फॉर कोलैब इज collab.research.com. ओके, collab.research.google.com. So when you open this collab.collaboratory.research.google.com, when you open this, it will prompt you to open some of the files which have already been opened by you, or probably new notebook, or cancel. And then on top you will observe there are several tabs. So first tab says example, then recent, then Google Drive, then GitHub, and upload. Okay. So if you have everything in your Google Drive, you can go to Google Drive and access from there. Otherwise, you can upload it. And while uploading, you go to upload, you choose file, and if you have those files in the system, you can go to them and you can access them. Like here, I'm opening one of the file which is there on my system. So if I open it, I'll be opening this file. Okay, and then you can open. I'm not going to disturb. Yeah, I can open. Yes, it's a new tab. So if I open this, you see, I will be clicking it, and then it will upload the program file. And it will open the Python notebook for you. Now, Google Colab notebook is very similar to the Jupyter notebook that many of you must be aware about, and it follows the same pattern. It's just that it is provided by Google and it runs on Google's data server. So you see on the right hand side, you see over here, you will find a connect button, right? Here you will find a connect button. If you click on this connect, it will connect you to just click on this connect. Okay. Click on this connect. Otherwise, beside this connect, there is an arrow, downward pointing arrow. On if you click on this arrow, you will find two options: connect to hosted runtime or connect to local runtime. Hosted runtime mean you are connecting with the Google data server. Okay. If you connect to local runtime, it means you will have to create an environment on your system. If you feel that your system has enough computational power and you want to run your deep learning programs on your system, then you can connect to local runtime and you'll have to create a server. And to create local runtime, if I click on local runtime, you see it will pop up instruction panel. An instruction panel on these, you can follow these instructions and learn how to create your local connection, how to create the server, and then that server will generate a URL. That URL will be pasted over here so that you can connect to your local machine, right? However, I'm not going to connect to local machine. That is something that I leave to you. I will directly connect to the default setting, which is hosted runtime. Okay, this hosted runtime is the data server of Google on which we'll be connecting. So it says if you click on connect, it will be prompting initializing Python 3 Google Compute Engine backend TPU. Okay, so it works on TPUs, which is Tensor Processing Unit. And now it is connected. When it's connected, it shows that the RAM and disk you are using. So if you just hover your mouse, put your mouse over it, don't click it. If you just put your mouse over there, you will observe a tooltip text which says connected to Python 3 Google Compute Engine backend TPU, and the RAM I'm using is 0.81 GB out of 12.72 GB allocated to me, and disk is 30.96 GB out of 107.77 GB allocated to my purposes, my account. Okay. Now I'm connected to Google server and I have uploaded my program file. Instead of if you want to do a fresh programming, you remember when I opened this tab, it asked me to create a new. So if I open this tab, it will ask also, instead of opening the a pre-existing program, it will prompt you to open a notebook, new notebook also. So here you can open a new notebook and you can do your fresh programming. No need to just copy or execute the I mean, it's not only necessary that you take someone else's code, you can do your own programming also, a fresh programming. Okay, so I cancel and come back to this. So I was here. I was here. So I did this program, DL class 1 in the first class. I will just open that and go through once again, DL class 1. Okay. I think everybody is able to access the Google Drive or not. See, accessing Google Drive is very important because I have uploaded so many things over there. If any one of you is not able to access, please let me know. Please let me know. Okay. I have shared a link of Google Drive and
Sir, can you share the link at the mail? Actually, you have shared the link on the WhatsApp. कैन यू अगेन शेयर द लिंक ऑन द मेल?
आर यू नॉट एबल टू एक्सेस व्हाट्सएप? आर यू नॉट
यस
ऑन
सर,
व्हाट्सएप ग्रुप?
या
सी,
आई एम ऑन द व्हाट्सएप ग्रुप.
if you are in the WhatsApp group, you should be able to access that link. And then I think that I am actually following the WhatsApp group.
Okay sir, I'm just done.
I'm pasting it again on the WhatsApp group, because you see, managing through WhatsApp is very easy for me. And then ultimately, when I'll compile the people who have attended my classes, I see there are 170 people, some 170 some people who are on the WhatsApp, and I every day I feel some of the people joining and leaving. So it will be very easy for me to finally compile the list of people who have attended my session, right?
Sir,
So
I'm
if
also
you
not
want to,
there on WhatsApp.
I'm also not on the WhatsApp group.
I will request everyone
Share
to join the WhatsApp group. Okay.
Because it was
I had sent the link. I will send the link again. You can join the WhatsApp group.
Okay. On this chat window, because we are accessing this WebEx link, it will be easy to get the link on this chat window only.
Both ways I am sharing. I will be sharing it both ways. But the thing is, for me to manage WhatsApp is necessary. I manage it from there. This is the Google Drive link. You can join it. You can access it. If you have Google account, you can access it. If you are accessing it with your institute ID or institute email ID or some other non-Google email ID, then I will probably have to add you over there. Just message me on the WhatsApp and I'll be able to do it. You see, when you send an email to me, there are so many emails that are coming by default from WebEx, from sessions, from AICT, that for past 1 week I haven't even accessed my official emails. So it is very tough to find somebody's request in the deluge of emails that I'm getting. And when I'm on WhatsApp, I just browse through all the messages and I see them immediately, I'll be able to help you with anything. Okay, so you might feel that I'm not responding to your email, but unfortunately I'm not even able to see your email. And so it will be very easy for me to manage. Please help me here, join the WhatsApp group and kind of help me help you, right? So we are back on DL class 1 program, and through this let's see. So this is the Pima Indian data set I had uploaded. I'll connect this tab again. You see, as many tabs you open, those many threads are connected, those many threads are created. So it's not like one tab is connected means all the tabs will be connected. You will have to connect every thread, because every tab is a thread, is a new process for. I will run it quickly. I told you how to create a cell, so you can create a new cell. Like here I created a new cell from code. If you press code, you can create a new cell. If you press text, you can create a new cell, but this cell will be used for text writing. Like this is the text that I have written, this is the text I have written. I can also write some text over here. Like if I put hash, it will be heading 1, my new lecture. Okay, and when I press shift enter, it will so my new lecture. Now you see, this is a code cell, right? If I press shift and to run every cell, you have to press shift enter. Shift enter means so by pressing shift enter, you run execute that cell. Now this is a code cell. If I run this, of course hash means that this is a command, so it will not execute. But I used hash to indicate that this is going to be a heading. So the thing is, if in code cell you don't write text, okay? If you have to write text, you will have to use the text cell. Now this is a text cell. To convert one cell text code cell to text cell, you press Control MM, right? Plus M. My cell will become a markup cell or text cell instead of a code cell. Okay. Now this has become a markup cell. Now this is a markup cell in which my I can see my code. If you want to put it, if you want to make it bold, you put like this. At the end, you put two stars at the two asterisks at the beginning, two asterisks at the end, and it will make it bold. One hash make it heading one, two hashes make it heading two, three hashes make it heading three, and so on, right? So, and if you want to make it italic, probably you want to make it italics, you will have to put the underscore and it will become italics. Okay, this way you can beautify your code. If you are not using Google Drive, then how to access file and data set from local computer? From local computer, you can just see new notebook, open notebook, press open notebook. Mr. Yogesh is asking, if we are not using Google Drive, then how to access file and data set from local computer? For that, you open, go to file menu, click on open notebook, and you see this upload, right? This upload. This upload button. Click on this upload button. It will take you to a choose file option, right? You can go to choose file and then browse. I'm uploading from my system only. So you can do that. So this is a markup cell. This is a text cell, and I don't execute this cell. This cell is just for the purpose of. So I'll delete this cell by pressing Control MD, and see, this is a text. Execute this cell. It will print the string hello for me, and this is how we access a file. Now I'm again going back to our DL class 2, because from that right. So here I'll execute it and show you how we are doing it. Anything, you just have to see the data, and then this is the cell from where I'm actually going. In this program, I'm willing to show you that how you are going to evaluate the data set using the validation. Okay, so we will be doing an automatic validation, then we'll be doing a manual validation, and then finally we'll be doing a X-fold cross validation. After this completion of this session, you will know how to evaluate Keras model using automatic, manual, and k-fold cross validation. Keras can separate a portion of your training data into a validation data set and evaluate the performance of your model on that validation data set at each. To a percentage of the size of your training data set. For example, a reasonable value, might be 0.2, 0.33, indicating 20% or 30% of your training data, which is held back for the validation purposes. Now, among this, in this code, you can see I have imported Keras models.sequential, just like the previous program, Keras layers.dense. From Keras layers, I import dense layer. So you can see sequential is being imported from models class, dense is being imported from layers. So sequential is a type of model that I'm importing, and dense is a type of layer that I'm importing, that I have imported numpy. Then we fix the seed, numpy.random.seed. I could fix it to 7, I could fix it to 10, I could fix it to 5, I don't care. Now I'm going to load this data set. So if I run this program, it will produce an error because it doesn't know where is the data set, right? So you would remember how I had loaded the data set. I will go over here, then I will click on mount drive, and then if I click on that, it will automatically mount the drive, right? Or I can just copy paste that code which was written over. Yeah, right. It has mounted my drive, and I can go to this drive. I can go to notebooks class, and this is my. Please try to understand. This is my directory structure. Your directory structure will be different. Okay, so you take this, and then you copy the path from here. Close it, and then I will just paste this path here. This is another way of mounting the drive, which is much easier. Last time I showed you a piece of code which will help you mount your Google Drive, but now over here I have done it automatically. I have just clicked on mount drive, and you can unmount it as well from here, right? So you now know both ways in one in this program. I'll close it. I'll close this as well. Repeat mount. Okay, you just have to click here. I'll unmount it to show that. It's initializing, so I'll have to wait. Right. You see icon of folder over here which says files. When you put your mouse over there, the tooltip text will say files. You click on this, you will see this file structure. And then here you can click on mount drive. You click on mount drive, it is going to mount the permit this notebook to access your Google Drive files. Connecting to Google Drive will permit code executed in this notebook to modify files in your Google Drive. So I want it to be done, connect to Google Drive, and then your drive will appear over here. Yes, now it is visible. I can click on this drive. This is showing my drive. I have my directory structure. I go to that, and then I access my files in this class too. I can access pmind and dataset. I just right click and copy path. I don't want to double click because it will upload it. I don't want to do that. I just need to find the path of that. Once I got the path of that, I will paste it over here. Okay, I'll paste the path over here and with the delimiter comma, because this is a comma separated file. Now you see my data set should be uploaded. Now after this, as you know, pmind and data set has 8 features, and the ninth column is after pressing mount drive, it is not uploaded. Rupa, probably you would remember that I had shown you the way to open the, if I show you one. I had shown you the code to upload that. Okay, this is very simple code. If you don't know how to if it is not working, probably this is the way to mount a drive as well. This is a very simple code written in a DL1. Okay, so I'll just copy from here and copy and paste it in this example as well, so that I get a new cell. I paste it over here. When I click this, it will tell me that my drive is already mounted, so I need to unmount it, and it will create a new runtime. It is reconnecting, allocating, connecting. So after this, I will just run this code. After running this code, it will give me a URL and then a text box to enter the authorization code. To get the authorization code, I need to go to this URL. This URL will take me to a new tab. I need to find out which email ID I am actually working on. So I remember my email ID and I accept this statement. After that, it will generate an authorization code. Just click on this button. Okay, or you can also copy paste this, no issue. But you click on this button, it will copy it for you and then come back to your notebook. Notepad, and then you paste it here, right? You paste it and then press enter, it will mount the drive for you. Yes, you need to mount the drive for every new session, and that is a headache, and it happens all the time. Every new session, not only every new session, every new tab and every new session, because every tab, if you have done operating systems course, probably you would remember that in Google Chrome, every tab is a new process, new thread. Okay, so this thread is all independent of the other tabs and other threads. So you will have to do it every time. And the biggest headache with Google Colab is that after some time of inactivity, it just disconnects you. Okay, so here it shows RAM and disk. After a few, probably half an hour, or I don't remember exactly the time duration, but after some duration of inactivity, it will disconnect you because it has also to do its optimization. But anyhow, we have mounted our drive. Then we here, I am splitting the data set into two parts, X as input and Y as the target label, target output. And then with this code, I create, I instantiate a new instance of sequential model. Then I add first layer. First layer is a dense layer. Dense layer has 12 neurons. Input dimension is 8 because my input has got 8 features. And activation function is rev, right? Similarly, we have dense second dense layer with 8 neurons, and activation function is again ReLU. Just specify the input dimension at the input layer, first layer only, first hidden layer only. Okay, then the first hidden layer, which has got 12 neurons, is the only layer in which we specify the input dimension, because the first layer needs to know what is the input size. After that, every layer is producing its output. So since this layer is known to the model would automatically adjust the number of inputs for succeeding layers. Okay, for the next layers, like I have three layers in it. I just specify number of input for first one, and remaining layers would automatically manage the input from coming from previous layer. So second layer is also a dense layer having 8 neurons, activation function ReLU. I do not specify input dimension over here. Then third one has only one neuron, activation function has sigmoid, because at the end I want a probability value. Then I compile my model, which is model.compile. During compilation, I need to specify at least three things. The loss function, in this case, I have binary cross entropy because this is a binary classification. Then optimizer for us is Adam. As I discussed last class also, the best and most suitable optimizer is Adam at the moment, until a new good better algorithm, better optimizer comes up. Adam is the best one. Matrix is again the accuracy matrix which we are going to use. After compiling, this compilation step actually takes care of is structured correctly. Right. After that, I need to train my model. For training, I use the fit function. So I have this fit function over here, model.fit xy, xy indicating the input and output. Validation is split is 0.33 indicating 33%. So if I have 1000 samples, 330 samples for validation and 670 samples for training. Number of epochs is 150, batch size is 10. I don't think I need to repeat the difference between batch size and epoch. So now we run it. Now we run, and after in the last line, we are just evaluating our model that after all the validations, what is the final output? What is the output model, output accuracy of the model. I press shift enter and it should run because I have given it the path of my data file. Now it is running. You see all the accuracies are being given to you. And you see when we do the fit function, when we run the fit function, in the fit function, I haven't specified the verbose parameter over here. Okay, so automatically verbose is taken to be 1. I can make it 0 as well. Now, after completion of 150 epochs, my all these details are given over here in every epoch. However, my accuracy is coming out to be, overall accuracy is coming out to be 76.82. You remember in fit I had given verbose previously. So I'll put verbose over here just for the sake of people who have joined recently. Verbose, I can make it to be 0. If I make it 0, you see I'm not seeing anything here, right? No messages, nothing, nothing, nothing. At the end, I will just see the result of this print statement. Accuracy, yeah, final accuracy, right? So verbose will control whether you want to see the detail of every epoch or not, and by default it is 1. By default it shows all the details to you. Now this is an automatic validation mechanism. Now I'm going to show you a manual verification data set in which Keras also allows you to manually specify the data set to use for validation during training. In this example, we use the handy train test split function from Python scikit-learn machine learning library to separate our data into a training and test data set. We use 67% for training and remaining 33% for the validation. Validation data set can be specified to fit function in Keras by the validation data argument. It takes a tuple of the input and output data sets. So you see, the rest of the things would remain same until this point. Okay, over here you see, so I'll start the annotation, do some annotation, and then I'll close it. So this is this place where I'm actually, this is the place where I'm actually, I have made a modification with the previous program. This line says X train, X test, Y train and Y test. Okay, so train test split function is taking your whole data X and Y. The testing size is 0.33, indicating 33%, and random state equal to seed. Random state is seed, means it will take the seed value, whatever seed you have specified. You have specified seed over here, and random state means it is actually going to take random 33% samples. Okay, we all know when we do the validation, we don't select first 33% or last 33% or somewhere in between. We do a random selection. So out of 100 samples, randomly 33 samples will be picked up for validation test. Okay, and if it is going to be a random number being generated, we should use seed, because every time we run it, we should be able to reproduce our result. And with the seed, fixed seed value, we will be able to reproduce our result. The randomness is not going to alter the number of times we do it. So then we create the model, model equal to sequential, dense, again the same thing, one layer, two layer, three layer. Then we compile at the time of compilation. We again provide binary cross entropy, optimizer as Adam, and matrix as accuracy. Everything is same except the fit statement. In the fit statement, you see, as I read over here, we provide X train and Y train. So instead of this part, when I had provided X and Y only over here, you see, I had provided X and Y and then specified the validation split. I'm providing it X train and Y train, and the validation data is altogether provided as X test and Y test, which is generated here through this split of 33%, right? So this is the validation data. Why I am showing you this split and showing the validation data? You might ask this question, as many students ask in this question. What is the difference between first program and second program? First one was easier because you are doing an automatic split, and here you have to do it manually. Yes, it's for the sake of learning. Although I have only one example, I'm showing you with one example only. It is for the sake of learning that if you are already having two sets of data set, one is called your training set and the other is called your validation set, then how would you specify your validation set to the fit function? So this is how you will provide validation data set to the fit function. Okay, so in that case you will not need to execute this statement because you would already have your validation data set kept separately with you. Validation set kept separately with you. So I have my training set like specified with this extend y train, and the validation set is specified with validation data argument. Specify x test and y test. Number of epochs is 15 and batch size is 10. I evaluate the model at the end and I run it. Before running, I'll just change this line because I don't want to get the error. So I'll change it. I will copy from here and paste so that my file is known to my program where it is. Then I press shift enter, and shift enter will start executing, and I see all the results, right? So you see accuracy has further reduced because number of epochs have reduced. So accuracy is 65.10. Now, third one is manual key fold cross validation. So you have done a validation, that validation was done only once. We have to do cross validation, and that is the ultimate benchmark for any machine learning algorithm. In any machine learning algorithm, you need to find out the cross validation accuracy. Okay, the gold standard for machine learning model evaluation is key fold cross validation. Cross validation is often not used for evaluating deep learning models because of the greater computational expenses. For example, k-fold cross validation is often used with 5 or 10 folds. As such, 5 or 10 models must be constructed and evaluated, which greatly adds to the evaluation time of the model. You would remember, you would know that when we do cross validation, every cross validation creates a new model and discards the old model. Okay. So in that way, as many times as you have to perform cross validation, those many models are created. You can discard or you can just keep it separately. That's up to you. You can save it. That's up to you. But if you do a 10-fold cross validation, that means 10 different models, machine learning algorithm models are created. And then we calculate the accuracy, validation accuracy for all these 10 models. And then we get the average cross validation accuracy. And that is what we call as CV accuracy, cross validation accuracy. So if you perform the same thing on deep learning model, because it becomes very tough, because one deep learning model will normally take 2 or 3 hours to complete and execute. And then if you have to perform it, have to perform cross validation on deep learning, it will take too much time. It will add to the total evaluation time. However, in this nevertheless, when the problem is small enough or if you have sufficient computing resources, k-fold cross validation can give you a less biased estimate of the performance of your model. In the example below, we use stratified k-fold class from the scikit-learn Python machine learning library. We split up the training data set into 10 folds. The folds are stratified, meaning that the algorithm attempts to balance the number of instances of each class in each fold. Okay. That is the meaning of stratification. The example creates and evaluates 10 models using 10 splits of the data and collects all the scores. So you see, I have this data set over here. I'll just copy my. So rest of the things will be same, except I have imported a new function, stratified key fold, from scikit-learn library, model selection library. I have imported this. Okay, seed equal to 7, numpy random seed seed. We have seeded with our data set is loaded from here. I split it into training and testing set input and labels. And then here I specify 10-fold cross validation test hardness. So key fold is specified as stratified key fold. I call the function and I specify through n splits argument. I specify how many splits I want. Shuffle definitely has to be true. And random seed is again the seed. Random state is again the seed that I have defined. This seed. Okay, the same seed I'm using to create all the random numbers. And now I create a list of CV scores. All the CV scores will be, this is an empty list. At this point, I will be adding all the CV scores in this. Now you see. So for train test in kfold dot splits, right? Kfold will have number of splits 10. Let me reduce it to 5 and see first, and then I see how much time it takes, and then I will execute it. So I have all the splits in kfold. So train and test in kfold dot splits. I run this loop. I have to create model every time. You remember this thing in k-fold cross validation, as many folds you perform, those many machine learning models you will have to create. That is why the creation of model, this creation of model is happening inside this for loop. Okay, so creation of model, construction of model, compilation of model, fitting of the model, and evaluation, everything happens inside the for loop. Not like I create a model out of this for loop and run it again and again, because then I'm training the same model again and again. So ultimately it is learning, adding up its learning. That should not happen. Right. So I create my model exactly like we have done previously, then compile it using the same command. Instead of providing the validation value over here, like over here I have specified validation data previously in the previous program. Now I'm not going to provide any validation. Okay, I have X train and Y train, and then epochs 150, epochs batch size 10, verbose equal to 0. I don't want too much to be displayed over here for every fold, so I have put verbose as 0, and then let's see what it is printing. Then we'll decide whether split stands for. Okay, there is a question from Dr. Bharti Sharma that can you explain what split stands for? Split is a division of your complete data set. Okay. So K-fold split means I want to do a K-fold cross validation. K-fold means K could be any number. You could do 5-fold cross validation. You could do 10-fold cross validation. 1, 2, 3. What is the difference between
plain the meaning of 5-fold or 6-fold? What will the going to do in this? We will divide our data set into 5 groups. Or what is the meaning of this?
Okay, ma'am. Okay. So yes. Then I'll have to start from scratch. See, again, I had told this thing in the last class, last lab session when I discussed program one. Okay, suppose you have a set of 100 questions that you have created on a topic for your class. Okay, so topic is, let's say, operating systems, threading, right? Processes and threading. On threading, process threading, you have 100 questions that you have created. Out of 100 questions, while you are discussing the topic in the class, you will train your class on some questions. What do we mean by training your class on those questions? Means, suppose you have 50 questions on that you solve in the class. Okay. So in a class, you will solve 50 questions. Let's assume that you solve 5 questions. Okay. So you have selected 50 questions, and then you have selected, say, 20 questions for validation, and let's say you have stored 30 questions out of those 100 for testing. Now I'll tell you what do they mean. 50 questions for training, 20 questions for validation, and 30 questions for testing. So what do I really mean by that? What I mean is, if you have 50 questions for training, means you will solve 5 questions. and then in your class you will solve 5 questions on board and then ask the students immediately then and there, okay, you have a question, solve it, okay, in the class itself. If the students have understood the 5 questions that you showed them on the board, they will be able to solve it. Otherwise, they might face problems, they might not be able to solve it. Then you solve the question that you had given to them, okay, and show it to them how to solve it. Now, when you first solved 5 questions, that was your training set, okay, without even asking anything, you taught them how to solve a problem. Then you give them a question. This question was not to test them, but to validate them, okay, whether they are understanding or not. That is your validation set. So if they are able to solve it, well and good. If not, you will solve it to show it to them, to train them, okay. So that is the purpose of validation set. Validation set is there to test whether your model is actually learning or not. Validation is the kind of testing at the time of training. Okay. But these questions, the 50 questions that you have kept for solving in the class on the board, correctly learning or not, are not going to be part of your examination paper, are they? You don't give any question in the examination which you have already solved, and if you give, it's your choice, but normally we don't give any question in the examination paper that we have already solved, because that is very easy for them. So that is their real examination, that is their testing. Okay, so you have created a student model which you trained on 50 question, and then you give in during the training, you give them 20 more questions. Okay, let's see how what you learn. And if they don't learn those 20 questions, you will solve them, right? It's not like you leave them unsolved in the tutorial session or in the classroom session. You solve those questions. So validation set is also a set on which one day or other you will train your model. Okay. However, testing set is one set which is never showed to the model. The train model is never trained on the testing data set, never ever, right? It's never ever trained on the testing set. Testing set is there only for the purpose of examining the model. Same is the way we apply over here. CV score in code. The purpose of CV score is to test, is to check what is the learning accuracy of your model, right? So while you are training, at the time of training also, you need to understand your model is learning in a good way or not. If it is not learning, then you will have an indication to change your hyperparameter, right? Like over here, I am performing a for loop. I am performing a cross. First, but let me just go through, and then I'll come back to what is k fold and split. So during this validation, what I have done, I have trained it on some examples, like 50 examples, and then I tested my student on one question. I trained it on 5 example and then ask a question from my student. My student was not able to solve any of the question I gave to the student. So what would I feel? Either there is a problem with the student or there is a problem with me, right? I'm not able to train the student properly, or the student's architecture is not good. So what I'll do, I will change the architecture of a student. Okay. In your class, you cannot change the brain of your student. So what do? You check for other student. You check other student is able to solve. No, that student is also not able to solve. Then you check for third student, that also has different architecture. Suppose that student is able to solve the problem, the validation problem. Okay, it means it's not the problem with your training methodology. It's the problem with the student's architecture. Right, so you have 3 models, 2 models we are not learning, 2 student models we are not learning, but the third model is learning. So it is probably the third model has a brain or has a model, a machine learning model, which is more better for this kind of learning. Similarly, if you do k-fold cross-validation, suppose you have 10-fold cross-validation. So what do? You create 10 different training sets, 10 different validation sets, right? So you have, so out of, suppose I have 100 examples, okay? 100 examples with me. Out of these 100 examples, I will create 70 plus 30. Pardon my handwriting. 100 will be divided into 70 plus 30. Now this 70 is my training set. Okay, this 70 is my training set and this 30 is my validation set. Now I should ask a question to you, which 70 out of 100 samples, which 70 will you take and which 30 will you take for validation? No one has this answer. Okay, because there should not be any preference. I am trying to create a general model, generalized model. So there should not be any preference. It's not like I'll take first 70 and last 30. It should not be like that. You randomly pick 30 examples, okay, and leave the remaining for to be trained. But if you are picking randomly, if you are randomly picking 30, so you pick one random, then you pick second random. In second random, again, you have 100 divided into 70 plus 30. That is a basic concept of cross validation. Okay, 70 plus 30. Now, first random selection of 70, 30 will be different than second selection of 70 and 30. Okay, why will it be different? Because you're randomly picking the 70 or randomly picking the 30 examples. So, definitely, if your random number is good, the second 30, the set of second 30, there might be some common examples. I'm not saying there won't be any common examples, but then you will have some common examples, but not all 30. All 30 cannot be same if your random number is good, if your random number generator is good. So you randomly pick 30 in the first case, that is one fold cross validation. Then you randomly pick 30 in the second loop, that becomes second fold cross validation. Similarly, you have third fold, you have fourth fold, and over here, since I'm doing how many folds I'm doing? I'm doing five splits, so I'm doing five fold cross validation, right? So I have to do five random splits of 70 and 30. Okay, and for this, so in first loop, the first random 70 will be trained and first random 30 will be tested. In second fold, first random 70 will be trained and second random 30 will be tested, and so on. So this goes on for five folds. Normally people go for 10 fold cross validation. That is a standard benchmark. People go for 10 fold cross validation. How many fold is sufficient? 10. 10. A standard benchmark is 10 fold cross validation, right? So we split. Now where is the testing data? I had 100 examples, I divided it into 70 and 30. Then where is the testing data? As I told you, you never train your model on the testing data. Yes, very true. But you had 100 samples. Now you have trained on all the sample. Okay, tell me one thing. Have I trained on all the samples in this? Have I really trained on all samples, or I have not trained on some of the samples? What is your perception? What is your understanding? Anyone? Ms. Gaganpreet.
Might be or might be not. But in the one go, we have trained only on 70. Not
exactly.
On
you might or you might not. You never know. Because you are randomly picking the 70. It might happen that some of the examples are always coming in 70, 70, 70, 70. And it might happen that there are some examples that they never appear in these 70. Okay, in these 70, they never appear. So it is beyond your control, and that is a good thing, right? So it is a good thing that you don't have too many things in your control. As we are taking random samples, so random samples mean, suppose I have a sample number, sample marked like this, this sample, okay, this per purple sample. I don't know what color it is. Okay, let us assume this is purple sample. This purple sample is coming over here. This purple sample is coming in 30, and every time it is coming in 30 only. It is never coming in the 70 region. Then what happens? This 30 was never trained upon, right? And since it is random, you cannot control which example will come in 70, which example will come in 30. You are randomly picking 30. So it might happen that it is appearing in 30 only, the validation set only. And validation set is something you are testing upon during the training time. So we don't really have any control, and we can't really say that your training is done on all 100 samples, or your training is missing some of the samples. We cannot claim that. But during X-fold cross-validation, K-fold cross-validation, we have done this 70-30, 70-30 X times. Okay. Now, where is your training set? Now, in this problem, there is no training set. Definitely, there is no training set at all, because I have used all my samples for training and validation. Training and validation. Now, since I don't know if there is a sample which has been trained upon or not, so I don't claim that there might be some examples in this 100 which are not trained. I don't know. You can't say it for sure. So I don't treat any of the samples out of this 100 for testing. If you do, that is an academic dishonesty. Zoom on the code. I'm not even looking at the code. I'm just annotating and making faces over here. So, right. So if you test on your training set, that is academic dishonesty, and you will not get a model. So what do we do? What we do is, the code visible now? I have zoomed it a bit.
Yes, sir, it is visible.
Fine. So that is the K-fold cross validation, you see. So what I have done, I have done 5 splits. So 5 random splits will be done, and 5 sets will be created. What 5 sets? 5 sets of 70-30, 70-30, 70-30, 70-30, and 70-30. So 5 sets are created. And the same training example of 100 examples are divided into 5 sets of 70 plus 30, 70 plus 30, 70 plus 30. And those 70s are randomly selected. Those 30s are the remaining ones, like that. So for every split, I'm going to perform a model creation, model compilation, model training, and then validation. I will not call it testing, I will call it validation. So if I run it, something is happening, but since verbose is zero, it is not showing me complete detail, but this is accuracy, I suppose, for the first fold. Okay, and it is still running. You can see it is still running. Yeah, so second fold cross validation accuracy. Now this is called cross validation accuracy. Why it is called cross validation? Because I'm not just doing validation, I'm cross validating against different sets of split, different sets of splits. One set of split has a random 70 samples plus 30 sample. The second set of a split has random 70 plus 30, third set has random 70 plus 30, and so on. So I have 5 sets of splits, and since I'm validating against different models and different splits, that is why it is called cross validation. First or second, you just take one split and call it first. In the loop, you take first split or second split, doesn't matter. We don't care which one is first or second or third. Okay. So accuracy is 73% for first fold, third, second fold, 73, third fold, 65, fourth fold, 73, and then 71. On an average, the accuracy is 71.49, and the standard deviation is STD score is 3%. Right. So this is how we do X fold cross validation. Right? Any question now?
So if we want to publish any paper, then we give this accuracy in that paper. It means we are supposed to do a K fold validation.
Yes, 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 definitely. You are supposed to do a K fold cross validation. K is normally 10. When you have a big model like deep learning model, then you can reduce the number of K, make it 5. Don't go beneath 5. But 10 fold cross validation is the gold standard. And when you do cross validation testing, you perform this, you report this error, this accuracy 71.49% as the cross validation accuracy with standard deviation of 3%. This is how we report it in the paper.
One more doubt. Suppose we have a diabetes patient data set and we have trained their data set. Now we want to check, we have symptoms of any patient and now we want to check whether he is a diabetic or not. How can we give that input to our model?
Yeah, that we predict. Okay, prediction I will show you in the next one. If this model is trained, then you, what you need to do, this is, that is just kind of testing. Okay, prediction or testing. So when you are trying to predict, I will just put it and predict this model. I'll show you that. I'll show you that. Is this example clear?
Ooja sir, I have
just muted everyone. Somebody was saying, I am sorry. Please unmute yourself and say, I just muted. Hello. Yes, sir. You were saying something. Yeah, please.
Good morning, first of all. So when you are calculating validation in each and every section, so after that you will do an average at the end?
Yes, we do the average.
So how you will calculate it, standard deviation on that?
Standard deviation between these values only. You just calculate the mean and standard deviation between these five values only. What is the variation? I mean, the division from the mean.
And what about the test set, sir?
Yes, test set, at this point I don't have a test set, right? So that is why what people do to report the testing accuracy, what they would do, they would, I have limited set. Okay, suppose I have a limited set of data, like I just said about 100. Please mute your mic. I'm telling you, huh? So I will divide my 100 into 80 plus 20. Right? And this I will keep as a test set. Right? I will keep it as test. Now instead of that 70 plus 30, I will take this 80 and perform my train validation on this one. Training and validation on
this. We have mentioned this ratio in our code, that the ratio will be 80%.
In where?
Across validation, we have not mentioned that how much ratio will be for training and how much will be for testing.
Split, you have specified, na? In split, you had specified when you in the split.
Split is, we are training our data set for how many times? If split is 5, it means we are training our model to the data set for 5 times.
See, it is taking by default. I think it is taking by default the percentage, and that percentage is most of the time 33%, 30%, 33%. You can manage that as well. In this stratified k-fold, it is taking by default the percentage of training and validation. You can look for this thing, and I'll tell you. Stratified k-fold.
Sir,
please tell me.
Yes, sir. See, we have specified in that code above that 0.33 will be there for test size will be 0.33. So is this what is related to the one which ma'am asked about?
This is the one, this is the question, yes. In this it is taking a default code.
There we have mentioned in the code that 67% is for training and 33% is for test.
I have specified here.
I'll find it. Manual verification data set, in that code it is there.
There it is. But for this example, she has a very valid point that I'm not able to find the percentage in of it. Come back to you on this one. Okay. Model for segmentation. There is a question that is it mandatory to provide key fold cross validation for paper? If you have developed a model for segmentation, it's not necessary that every problem will require you to do a key fold cross validation. See, some of the time you can't actually, like in segmentation, the accuracy, measurement of accuracy is kind of subjective, right? So it is always better to have 4 or 5 models, then test them to see if your model is working perfectly or not, or your training method has some problem. So it's not always necessary to report it, but it is always a good idea to have a test on your own end to see how you are, how your model is performing. Is there a problem with the model or not? Is it overfitting? Because you see, many a times you feel that your model is giving you a very good result. Because I'll give you an example. I was working on a genetic algorithm problem and it was a multi-objective optimization. So when I was working, I was getting very good result. Then I somehow ran it 4 or 5 times on different problems, different benchmark problem, and still the problem was the algorithm was giving very good result. So I had a doubt, when you keep on getting very good results, that is the right time to start doubting your method. Okay, because it should not happen that your model will work on all different benchmark problem. There are deficiencies in every problem. So it is better to do these cross-fold validations. No. When we are doing the K-fold cross-validation, all the data is your training data. Okay. Testing is what I have kept separately. That is what I was telling. Then I stopped in between. You have 100 examples, then what you do 80 plus 20, okay, 80 plus 20, keep this 20 separate. This is a complete no, okay, you don't touch this. You do your validation on training and validation on this part only this part, okay, you don't touch this 20%. So the K-fold cross validation split will be working on this 80% only. Folding is done on 80% data only. 20 is totally separate for examination purposes only. Okay. And then when you report the accuracy of your model, the testing accuracy of your model, that testing accuracy will be on this 20%, not on 80%. 80% you specify, you report the CV accuracy, cross validation. Okay, so I'll move on to my next example. My next example is, since I have so many examples accumulated, I actually need to work through very quickly. Right. Yes, Dr. Vivek Tiwari is actually pitching in, and he is very true when he says that apply key fold on 80% and later test accuracy on the remaining 20%. We don't touch 20%. 20% becomes our kind of untouchable data. Okay, so I'll move on to 3. you all can also open DL class 3. This is a program in which I have something for you to see, but I will not run it. Okay, this program actually tells you how to optimize the parameters of your model, right? So you will see over here, you will see over here that we use Keras models for scikit-learn for general machine learning. And in this, I will just read through some of the things. See, the scikit-learn library is the most popular library for general machine learning in Python. In this lesson, you will discover how you can use deep learning models for Keras with the scikit-learn library in Python. After completing this lesson, you will know how to wrap a Keras model for use with scikit-learn machine learning library, how to easily evaluate Keras models using cross-validation, and how to tune Keras model hyperparameters using grid search in scikit-learn. Okay. So you see, evaluation of model using resampling method like k-fold cross-validation and efficient search and evaluation of hyperparameter. Everyone was asking this question that how to decide upon the value of hyperparameter. Now that is a question which is very tough to answer. But here I will try to. Yes, sir. When I showed the code to you, the 80% was the 100%, right? Over there, I did not split anything into training and testing. I utilized all the data I had for training cross validation. So that 80% that I'm referring to was my 100% data, all the data I had taken for training. Okay. So let us evaluate models with cross validation. The Keras classifier and Keras regressor classes in Keras take an argument build function, which is the name of the function to call to create your model. You must define a function, you can name it whatever you like, that defines your model, compiles it and returns it. In this example, we define a function create model, create a simple multi-layer neural network for the problem. We pass this function name to the Keras classifier class by the built fn argument. We also pass in additional arguments of epochs equal to 150 and batch size equal to 10. You can change it. These are automatically bundled up and passed on to the fit function, which is called internally by the Keras classifier class. So there are functions over functions I am adding now to make our program more complicated, but it is giving you more flexibility, more freedom in terms of how your model is being created and what all you things you can do with the model. In this example, we use the scikit-learn stratified k-fold to perform 10-fold stratified cross-validation. This is a resampling technique that can provide a robust estimate of the performance of a machine learning model on unseen data. We use the scikit-learn function cross-val score to evaluate our model using the cross-validation scheme, and then we print the result. So you see, we have an MLP. We will import these libraries from model. We import sequential from layers. We import dense, then scikit wrappers. We import Keras classifier. Then model selection. We import stratified k-fold, and then we import cross-val score, and finally we import the NumPy that we have been doing till now. Now we create a function, okay? We create a function to define our model, which is required by the Keras classifier function. And how do we define this? In Python, we know def create model. We have our name, and in this model equal to sequential, we are just utilizing the same code again and again to create our model. So model equal to sequential model dot add. We have 10 neurons, 8 neurons and 1 neuron, 3 layers. Then we compile the model, and then once the model is compiled, then only the model is created. Okay, and then we return the model. So whenever we call the function, this function will return this model, this deep net model. Fix the random seed, then data set equal to numpy dot load data, text data. I will just paste the value over here, indicating I need to load it also. So the drive is loaded and it will fetch this file from there and I split it into input and target labels. Then I create model using the Keras classifier function. The model equal to Keras classifier build fn, the model that was built above over here. You see, I'll just remove it. So the model that was written by this function, create model function, number of epochs that we can specify, batch size equal to 10 and verbose equal to 0 because I don't want too many things to be written. Now I evaluate using 10 fold cross validation, k fold equal to stratified, k fold and splits equal to 10, shuffle through random state c, right? And result is cross val score takes the model x, y, and then key fold is specified over here. How many folds will be there? It is specified, and then we print the result. We run it. So these are the accuracies obtained in 10 folds. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. 10 values are specified over here indicating that these are the accuracies. I have stored it in the result and this is the accuracies. I printed the result and then the mean of the result is 0.67, means 67% accuracy obtained through this. So Keras classifier function is taking care of creating the model, number of epochs, and this k fold, stratified k fold will run it a number of times and it will create it for you. Now, grid search deep learning model parameter. Now, this is the part which I will not run. In fact, I have Keras classifier. Okay, Keras classifier, as I said over here, Keras classifier and Keras regressor classes in Keras take an argument build function, which is the name of the function to call to create your model. Now you have defined your model, compile and return it. So this Keras classifier class by the build in function, we also pass additional argument epoch 150 and batch 10. These are automatically bundled up to for to pass to fit function, which is called internally by the Keras classifier class. It's nothing but just a Keras classifier and Keras regressor classes are the classes with which you can do the same thing that we had done earlier also. Okay, so effectively we are doing a wrapping of Keras model with the scikit-learn library. That's all. Okay, we are just using the create model function, and then you can have this function defined somewhere which will return the function, and then you can use the classifier or regressor provided by scikit-learn library. Okay, so this is a scikit-learn function which will classes in Keras. So they it's a wrapping over the scikit-learn function. This is just another way of doing it. It's not something that is replacing something, or we are doing adding anything new on top of previously seen. It's just a new function that I'm demonstrating. Okay, it's actually doing the same thing that I had shown in the previous program also. Now in this example, this next example that I have, we use a grid search to evaluate different configurations for our neural network model and report on the combination that provide the best estimated performance. Now this was this program will answer many questions that were asked previously in past 2-3 days. How to choose upon the parameter values? So this program is made to answer the questions of which hyperparameter value should we choose, or what should be the value of the hyperparameter we have. Now, as I have been telling you, I don't know. It all depends upon, and the best starting point is if you have referred a paper for your problem, then the best thing is choose the hyperparameters they have implemented in their paper and try to then start from there. Okay. So in this example, what we are doing over here is we are changing the hyper hyperparameters that you have set, and then it will find out the cross validation accuracy and tell you which set of hyperparameters are the best hyperparameter. So it takes the create model function defined to take two arguments, optimizer and init, both of which must have default values. This will allow us to evaluate the effect of using different optimization algorithms and weight initialization scheme for our network. After creating our model, we define arrays of values for the parameter we wish to search, specifically optimizer for searching different weight values, initializer for preparing the network weights using different scheme, number of epochs for training the model for different number of exposure to training data set, and batches for varying the number of samples before the weight updates. Now these are the four things we have selected over here to see what values are most suitable. So which optimizer is the most suitable? Okay, what is the initialization method for network weight? As I told you yesterday also, the network weights are randomly initialized, but then again, apart from random initialization, there are different techniques with which you could initialize the weight value of edges. So we will check upon different initializers, how many epochs the model should be trained upon, that is also which we will test over here, check over here, and how many batches you should create, what should be the batch size, right? You understand, if I have to test upon all these combinations, different combination of four different possibilities, four different parameters and different combinations of these parameter, it will take too much time. In fact, I have never seen the end of this program. I have run it four or five times, but I was not patient enough to see the end of this program. So I really don't know what is the output of this program, but I can just read through this program so you understand, and you have the code so you can run it on your own and see for your small model what is the best parameter, hyperparameter value. So it takes this grid search CV function from scikit-learn model selection, and rest of the things we have already seen. What it does is create model using optimizer equal to RMS prop, init equal to glorot uniform. Okay, so initialization mechanism is also defined over here. How do we create our model? We have sequential, first layer, second layer, third layer, then we compile and return our model. Now in this, when we create our model, you see the optimizer is specified as this optimizer is specified over here, the RMS prop, and initialization mechanism is specified in the layer argument. When you call the dense function, in that function, scikit-learn is a library in available in Python, which will be just like NumPy, Matplotlib, scikit-learn, scipy. All these are libraries, and scikit-learn has a set of functions which are very useful. So whoever is willing to work in machine learning domain should be aware of some of these libraries like NumPy, scipy, Matplotlib, scikit-learn. These are the four libraries related to, they are in, available in Python. So if you are willing to do some machine learning research, you should be aware about these four libraries. So you see in the dense function, I have specified the kernel initializer is specified as init. This init is taken as glorot uniform. Okay, so the default for this model is optimizer is RMS prop and init is glorot uniform. There are different values. I have another program in which I'll probably show you what are the different initialization mechanism. For any time kind of data set, the optimizer and initialization mechanism can remain same because See, for deep learning models, for the neural network, there is no difference between image and anything else. Everything is taken as numeric value. Okay, so initialization can also be anything. So I have defined the kernel initializer as init, and then that becomes the default value. Now, seed is 7, numpy random seed, load data set. I load my data set over here, divided into input and target. Then I create the model, which is using the Keras classifier function. I call the build function create model and verbose equal to 0. But to perform the grid search, epochs, batch size, and optimizer, we perform put optimizers as RMS prop or Adam. You can put as many optimizers as you want over here. Initialization mechanisms, I have put as 3 initialization mechanisms: glorot uniform, normal, and uniform. Epochs, 50 epoch, 100 epoch, and 150 epoch. Batches, 5, 10, 20. Okay. Now, all the grid search parameters will be stored in this dictionary. We create a dictionary of optimizers, epochs, batch sizes, and inits, because it takes the takes a dictionary. In the grid search function, takes the dictionary value as an argument, in which all the values will be stored. So you have optimizers. These are the optimizers. These are the optimizers over here. The epochs is defined over here. The batches is defined by this list, and inits are defined by this list. So this parameter grid is a dictionary. This dictionary is passed to this grid search function. And estimator is the model. Model is what I'm getting from the Keras classifier. Okay. Now grid search equal to grid fit. Now grid fit function will perform parameter grid and grid. Okay, parameter grid is just a dictionary. Okay, parameter grid is just a dictionary which has all the available options for optimizers, inits, initialization mechanisms, number of epochs, and batches. Ultimately, what I want to do is run through different combinations. So I have 4 hyperparameter and 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11 values for respective hyperparameter. So I have to run through, I have to find all the possible permutation combinations so that I come up with the best set of hyperparameter values. Okay. For that, I have created a dictionary. Now, dictionary is just a data structure, and this data structure available in Python, which is taking 3-4 lists. Optimizer list, epoch list, batch sizes, and inits, initialization mechanism. So it will take 4 lists and create a dictionary. Now this dictionary is called as given a name parameter grid. Now this grid parameter grid will be passed to the grid search CV function, which I have imported from the scikit-learn library. Okay, so this grid search function is imported here. Now this grid search function will take estimator model, which is initialized over here, right? The estimator model is initialized over here. Then it will take model as first argument and the dictionary parameter grid as the second argument, and it will create it will return a value to you in terms of grid. Now this grid can be fitted. The fit function available with this class can fit your parameter values, okay, utilizing one of the combinations of these 4 hyperparameter. So it will fit it and as many combinations possible, as much it will run, and then finally it will print the result for you. Okay, so means of all the CV results, standard deviation, parameters, etc. So it will do everything for you. Okay, now in this way you can have a search. You can make this program run for 1 or 2 days, and then you can search for the possible best possible combination of these 11 parameter values, so that the best parameter value, the best accuracy will tell you which parameter value was the best one, right? I'm not going to run this program because that program takes too much time to run. As you can understand, finding through all the values is time consuming. So this is 3. I'll move on to Okay, so I'll stop now in this session. In next section, I'll start with how many programs do I have? Yeah, sure. Attendance sheet. Definitely.
What is the difference between K-fold cross validation and this one?
There is a huge difference. There is a huge difference. In this, I'm not in fact doing K-fold cross validation. I'm searching for hyperparameter values. How I move that data to my drive, ma'am, you will have to upload it.
You will have to... talking about the model which we have discussed before, that machine learning model. Mm-hmm. What is the use of this model over K-fold cross validation?
I'm not getting your question. Please repeat again.
We have discussed in the starting this class 3, the first model, the scikit-learn for general machine learning.
Scikit-learn, yeah.
Scikit-learn, yes. Sir, what is the use of this model over K-fold cross validation? In this, we have this... created model twice. Yes, sir.
Which one, the first program or the second program?
Sir, this first one.
First one, this one, right? No, both of them are same. Both of them are same. It is doing a K-fold cross validation over here as well. Okay, and the previous one is also doing K-fold cross validation. I'm just in here in this program. I'm just telling you to use this function, Keras classifier function, Keras classifier class. Otherwise, rest of the things.
So, what is the use of this? That's I'm not getting the use of this classifier.
The time the functions are provided to use, when you use this function instead of making your own code, when you use this function, this is optimized in the back end. Okay, so when you use this function instead of creating your K-fold cross validation, it is more optimized and it might take a lesser amount of time than to run your own K-fold cross validation. So to the previous way of programming, no issues at all. Okay. Gaganpreet ma'am, am I able to answer the question?
Sir, yes. Thank you, sir.
Okay. So, what is the? Can we set seed as a parameter in optimizer? We see my chat, I have given you four links, session 1, 2, 3, 4, and then I am going to give you this session also.
Session 10.
Now this is I have 143 people in at this moment. So I have given you the session 10, right? And I have also shared session 1, 2, 3, 4. As if you scroll up, you will find that in chat, I have given four session.
Yes, sir, we noticed.
Yeah, so please, whoever is missing, you may fill in and then I will close when I start the next session. Okay, because I don't want everyone to be feeling that, okay, I don't need to attend the session, just I need to come up and fill the form. I will close all the four session. So whoever is attending right now, I have 144 participants. I think these many are the serious ones. So you fill in all the forms, and then I will close it after half an hour at 12 o'clock when I start my next session. I will close all the 4-5 forms, okay, including session 10 and session 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, so I will stop the sharing of the screen now.
Yes, sir, can I ask you one thing?
Yeah, please.
Sir, like tomorrow we have test na?
Yes, we have a test.
So like, what is the pattern? What you are
there will be I will create a Google form. In that form I can have quizzes. So I will create a set of MCQ questions, multiple objective questions. So you will just select one of the questions, whichever is correct.
MCQ questions will be based on all these videos and the lecture series that you are taking, no? Sir, one more thing, I have one problem. The data that you have shared is in my shared with me folder, and I'm not able to move it into my drive. So that's why I'm not unable to upload that in Google Colab file. Hello?
You can download it.
Sir, I have downloaded it and then I have to reload it.
So what is the problem? Downloading is the problem or uploading is the problem?
Sir, actually the link that you have shared, that I have clicked on it, and the data is moved in that folder, that is shared with me folder in a Google Drive. And now when I'm mounting it in that Colab, so it is just showing my drive. So obviously the shared with me folder is not there in my drive. So
definitely it will not be
there. So how to move? So what should I do?
Put all the data. Okay.
That means should I download it from shared with me folder and then again I will upload it into my drive?
Exactly.
Okay, fine. Okay, sir. Thank you so much.
So next session is going to begin at
12.
All right.
I can't find the link of 10th session. 10 minutes link.
Session. I just shared. I think.
11:39, ma'am. Check the 11:39 at the chat box. Sir, share us.
I pasted again. And Swati ma'am also pasted. Okay. Thanks.
Sir, already those are the filling the previous form for session 1 to 5. So they need to submit again. Hello.
Hi.
Hello.
Anybody tell me exact timing of session 1 and 2, because we are late in that session due to some technology issue.
Session will start by 12 o'clock, sir.
हेलो हेलो हेलो,